I'd like to thank you for coming to our today's presentation. We have a very exciting presentation lined up for you. I know these days drones are a hot issue, and everyone is interested about drones. So we're going to learn about drones in the next hour or so, and you'll have a chance to ask a lot of questions afterward once they finish their presentations. A few announcements. We have, as you know, this is one of our monthly meetings. By the way, my name is Arik Garabegyan, and then also we have a few of our board ASA board members here. You know that the ASA is putting this monthly lectures, and we'd like to hear from you. If you have any ideas what you want to hear in the next lectures, please let us know, and we'll try to find it. Or if you know somebody that's interesting subject they can talk about it, please let us know about that. Next one will be on May 24th. Again, it's here. That's going to be a Hyperloop. You probably all heard about that, that they're going to put us in the tubes and we're going to send us fast to some other places. And then in June, presentation going to be about that high-rise building that they're building in a downtown called Rousseau Grand, I believe, which is like the tallest building west of Mississippi. So the chief structure engineer is going to tell us about what's going to happen there. And then we're going to have a lecture in July about renewable energy in Armenia. That's going to be also interesting. We have a guest from Armenia who's going to be talking about that. And we line up a couple of other things. We have one which is about artificial intelligence. That's another thing which we have lined up, which will be, again, an interesting topic. Now, as of now, our presentation has been first come, first serve. We're going to do a little bit change, so be aware of that in the future. Even though it's a first come, first serve, we're going to give priority to ASA members. So being as an ASA member, that would be one of the advantages. If we are like today, we are sold out, we're going to take our ASA members as an advantage. So you'll be aware of that. That's going to be our new policy from now on. That's what we're going to do. Now, today's we have two presenters. We have William Cashin, which is going to local, is here. And he's a founder of the Telsa Foundation. But he's telling me it's nothing to do with a Telsa car, so don't get confused. But he's going to be talking about regulations and FAA, the new regulations about drones, and what are the future applications, and what are we supposed to anticipate in the future. And again, you all have seen their bios. I'm not going to read it for you, but you know they're qualified people. And Naira, which is a professor at the University of Illinois, and she just came here for this presentation. And also, she's going to give a similar presentation tomorrow in the USC. If there's anyone interested that was not able to attend here today, they can go to USC and listen to her there. With that, William, it's yours. Please, we can start it.
Hi, thanks for coming tonight. As you said, Tesla Foundation is not a subsidy, even though I look an awful lot like Elon Musk. it's not associated with the Tesla the Tesla car company. We're mainly focused on Dr. Tesla, Nikola Tesla. Our history, my history, has been very, very tied to Nikola Tesla. I got to meet Nikola Tesla when I was in college at Notre Dame, and I worked on a crazy project with Dr. Andrew Zatteray, who was a pretty famous physicist. And I worked with Dr. Andrew Zatteray, and I knew it was a very interesting project when there was some information in the student lounge about he needed some intern to help him work on a project, and I got him on the phone and I said, "Oh, Dr. Zatteray, I'm here. I know about turbo mechanics, and I know about turbo conveyors and all that. What are we going to do?" And he said, "Wilhelm, we are going to find the nature of human beings." And I said, "Okay, this is going to be a good job." And I learned an awful lot about Nikola Tesla then, and some of the most interesting facts that I thought when I got older and I retired from doing all the car stuff that I did. We used to build controllers in Detroit, Michigan for all the car companies. We did all the beta controllers and operational systems. I designed I was involved with a lot of linear mechanics and for incremental movement instead of a high stroke movement. We basically came into the car companies in the third iteration of the Industrial Revolution when we finally brought in electromechanics that replaced fluid mechanics. And so after that, I decided to retire for a while when I sold my business, came here to California, and wrote a script about Tesla. And it's right now with Leonardo DiCaprio. Script's been approved by a couple of different people. We're trying to get it into Sony to get on one of the HBOs or whatever, in the Showtime or whatever. So look out for that in the next few years. It should be out. It's a really interesting story about Dr. Tesla. So anyway, like I said, I've had a real interest in Dr. Tesla. He actually was the inventor of robotics. A lot of people don't know all the things he invented. Of course, you folks probably do, are more aware of it. He was the guy who came up with patent for AC current for three phase. And he was also the guy who came up with radio. A lot of people don't know that, but it feels like Marconi did. Actually, Marconi just did a test. Dr. Tesla had the original patents for it, but you gotta watch my show, my series, and you'll learn all about that. But I'd like to start a little bit and talk a little bit about our foundation. We're a 501c3. We're focused on autonomous robotic systems. And the systems that I built in Detroit were all based on autonomy. We decentralized control systems in Detroit, and we localized them to the production site, and using small desktop computers this time. Our relationship is between humans and machines. That's our biggest worry. I lived through a time in the third cycle of the Industrial Revolution where we actually destroyed a lot of people's lives. And at the time, I didn't know it. I was so, I guess I knew it, but I probably ignored it. I was so excited about just developing the technology. Sensors were going from this big to this big. And I mean, I just couldn't do enough things. It was just so fun. And when I knew that it had made a difference, and what I thought that later on in my life I'd try to go back and make a change and see if I could make it better, is when I was in Japan, we worked for a company called Mitsubishi Heavy Industries, and they had a turbocharger manufacturing facility. And we took that facility from 1,868 people to 14. And all those people lost their jobs. At the time, the Japanese said, no, everyone has a job for life. This was 1984. Have a job for life within the factories, and I know that that wasn't the case. We destroyed a lot of lives. This is our biggest fear, and that's one of the reasons why the Tesla Foundation was formed, is to do a unification, a blend between human beings and machines. Because the fourth stage of the Industrial Revolution, which is now, is the age of autonomy, and that's when we can really end up, automating almost everything around us. The Tesla Foundation, when we first put the company together, we established the Tesla Award. The first person who was a recipient of the award was Lyndon Blue. We thought that would be the right person. He is one of the owners of General Atomics. It's a DoD company, but they make all the drones for military. They make the MQ-9 and the MQ-14 series, which one is they're both in the field of battle a lot. We started the Tesla School of Technology. Right now, it's in six colleges. We created curriculum to help children and young people and adults learn about UAS, UAVs, drones, and that program is going very, very well. And our whole thing was to help develop the minds of people to fly drones and the safe entry into the airspace. When I built my company in the past, I jumped from we went right to a position of where we built a robotics company, and we launched that company in 1981, and we were fast on the track. We didn't necessarily invent automotive manufacturing or production. But what we were doing was we were augmenting it to a new level of production quality and a new level of efficiency. But what we didn't do is we didn't play out these three stages, these three phases in developing the industry. And I really knew what happened. I mean, in 1987, we were getting to the point where we had to send PhDs on site to work on simple interfaces because we just hadn't trained anyone. And so this time when we're starting the drone industry and we're really involved with it, we decided to launch it in a correct stage. And so the first thing we did was we created an international trade association called UAVSA. And every year we put on a large event here in Los Angeles. We have another event that's going to be in Japan next year. We have two in Europe, and we have one in Australia that'll be out in 2017. So that was our goals, is to get the entire industry together so we could communicate and find out what everyone was doing around the world and understand, because it's the technology is moving so fast now. The next thing we decided to do was, as I said earlier, is deploy an educational program. And that educational program would help educate all the people so that we would not leave people behind all the time and not end up with a situation where either one, you were sending people who were way overvalued to do a simple job, or two, they would end up having to retire or not have a job at all. And so, and then the third one, of course, is our intervention into the market in a large way. And that's one of the things that I'll show you as we go on further that we're working on currently. UAVs have been around a long time. As I said, Dr. Tesla was basically the first person to make a radio-controlled vehicle, and he made a radio-controlled boat in 1897. The strange thing was he had a lot of issues to deal with. He was quite a performer. He had to actually become a performer because, for the most part, people were extremely religious, and they were very, very afraid of the things that he did, especially for freeform energy. But when he sailed his little boat in Madison Square Gardens in 1897, it's kind of ubiquitous to us now, remote control. We're so used to it, it's just a simple thing. You gotta remember, people showed up on horseback to see this. So this was the vision that this man had. 100 years later, we landed with the same strategy, the same technology, the Mars rover. I mean, that's pretty incredible. It gives me chills every time I say it. So he's a pretty big visionary. A lot of other guys who are companies or whoever who moved towards UAS, that moved towards it, of course, in the military and the DoD environments. And if you guys would like, there's chairs down here in front if you want to sit down. There's a couple over there, too. Just hate to see people stand, especially when I get.
Thank you.
So there were different vehicles that were produced that were aircraft, and they basically were flying bombs. They tried to do it not until the Second World War, when the Germans really developed the buzz bomb and the V2 rocket, the V1 and the V2 rocket. Until they had, you know, developed that program and implemented that program, there really wasn't a controlled flight. It was kind of a launched flight. UTS, or you know, unmanned transportation, is now coming into every form of our lives. Mercedes-Benz. I was just in Germany about 6 months ago, and I saw that vehicle up on the right-hand side. That's their new vehicle that's totally autonomous, does its own weight balancing, does everything. It's an amazing vehicle. The vehicles on the right are from a city that was built in Dubai that we went and visited. The boat underneath, the freighter underneath, is from Rolls-Royce. It's a design. And of course, the two trains at the bottom. UAS can be broken up into four different areas. Extreme high altitude, which are 50,000 feet to 100,000 feet AGL above ground. There's two companies, which there'll be very many of them, but there are two now, Google and Facebook. And they're doing that so they can have a controlled broadcast and increase their distribution base through telephone and other hardware all over the world, so they can increase the volume of their business. The second one, of course, in this example, you can see that's an MQ-9 Predator. They fly at about 50,000 to 100,000 feet also, but they typically are in an area of 100,000 feet, basically an area where air cargo, GIS, and communications groups will exist in our in the commercial world. Under that is an airplane that we're working with, and that's a Cessna Skymaster. That airplane has no man inside. We've flown it around the airport, it's landed, it's taken off, flown in a pattern, landed again, and it's good for about 1,500 to 20,000 feet. And then at the bottom, we have our new working space altitude of 0 to 500 feet HEL, and that, of course, again, is for simple delivery cargo, but it's what we deal with now, and the reason why, and I'll talk about this more towards the end of the presentation, it's the reason why the FAA is having so much difficulty. This is an airspace that didn't used to be a working airspace at all, 0 to 500 feet. It was more of a descent and a climb out altitude that everybody was flying through. They weren't using it as an area to work. And that's what the big differentiator is. Most of the drones that we know of, the quadcopters or whatever it might be, they're all flying in that altitude. Actually, they can fly successful in altitude. We all know when they go higher than that, one, you can't see them, and two, they just don't perform well at any high altitudes because propellers really aren't designed for that. What I thought I would do is, in the presentation, instead of going over every concept of how a drone can be used, I thought I would approach the two most important areas that we're working on. And one of the areas with fire, and the other area is with air cargo. And those are probably the most needed areas for us and the things that can change people's lives and can change our economic balance. So first we'll start with the fire program. The challenge in this program is that the internal fire evaluation, when the firemen get on the scene, they can't really, they have to conceive through their hopes and what they know about fires, basically the situation that the building's in at that time. Search for life, they need to search for life inside of the fire, inside of a building. And then of course there's always dangers of loss of life for the firefighters and the people and everyone maneuvering inside the building. A drone, the technology opportunities for the use of a drone in this environment is situational awareness. We can give them situational awareness either in the building or out of the building. We can do important things like we can do real-time updates with roof problems, hotspots, hidden burn holes, which I found out that 2,300 firemen died in the last 2 years from roof fires. When they get up on top of the roof, they fall through the roof. And so the drone is now going to be a new tool to identify those places so we won't lose people. There's no easy way to get people out of a fire. And there's no easy way to find fuel issues inside of a fire when you're inside of a building. They have to kind of immediately decipher what kind of fire it is and if they think that there's anyone in there and how they're going to get them out. A drone will be very, very helpful in that area. The FAA is very lenient. Well, let's just say they're lenient. They're lenient with firefighters and police. They only ask for firefighters and police to have a COA, which is a certificate of authorization. The certificate of authorization is mainly for folks in companies like utilities or in fire or police departments. It's basically for the FAA to know where you're at, when you're there, what you're doing, where you're trying to go. And it doesn't really get into training and education as much as the 333 application does, which I'll talk a little bit about in a little while. So after the application is completed and submitted, again, it's a comprehensive kind of operational technical review of what it is the police department is going to be doing with their equipment and where they're going to be going. They're going to be doing search and rescue, they're going to be doing firefighting, they're going to be doing gosh knows what else. But there are some provisions and limitations, but they're less likely And they're more likely to be approved for fire and police. The FAA doesn't like to stand in the way of those folks at all. One thing that we did find out in talking with LA Fire is that currently it cost American taxpayers, Los Angeles taxpayers, it cost Los Angeles taxpayers about $58 million a year to deploy fire trucks to small nothings that they don't know. They show up, you know, because you always hear fire trucks running up and down the road as soon as somebody gets in, you know, a fender bender, and because they have to deploy them. They're hoping that somehow the UAS can, the drones can offer them an ability to not have to deploy those folks until they find out it's a certain issue that they have to, you know, resolve. So what this whole program does is extends the pillars of operations. It improves their mobile teams, their first on location, their daily business is, you know, it's not seasonal, it's not in an environment where it only, you know, is an issue sometimes. They're always on call 24 hours a day. And it's a very data-rich thing. And this is a surprising thing that we'll talk about in a minute. You know, we believe at the Tesla Foundation that the data is the more important thing that's gonna come out of all this. We do believe that the platform's important because that's the ability to acquire the data and collect the data. But we also at the same time believe that what's important and has extreme value is the data and the use of the data so that AI can be balanced. Because that's another fear that we have that we're paying attention to, that we're involved with a lot of other folks working on artificial intelligence, and our fears for artificial intelligence has, if it goes in a bad direction. We used to write programs, we used to write hundreds of patches in the legacy systems that existed in the car companies for robotics, and God knows we didn't register any of those patches. We didn't really think about what anyone else did when they developed the work, when they developed the initial legacy product that existed. So it really worries us how that information can then work towards the humans in a negative way, the human beings who created the equipment. I know it sounds like Terminator, but in essence, that's what can happen. But this just gives you a little bit of feeling for the entire program and kind of how the extended business model of this program. And we show here to give you an idea how fast things are changing. Software, I mean, the hardware changes about every 6 months. There's a new iteration of hardware in some way. And about for software, the minor revisions are at least every 2 months. At least every 2 months, there's a new software application that comes out for drones. And we know that in public software, the acceptance is even faster than that. Education software updates, we're trying to help crews be involved with more and more education. Like I said earlier, that's a really, really important thing to us. The daily storage of data is not being managed at all yet. And that's one of the things that we're putting in place. We've created a banking system with the U.S. banks, the U.S. Bank Group, and the National Banking Group, and we created this bank system so that we can set up accounts for users, so users can put their data in those accounts, because data is of value, as you know. That's how the companies of Facebook and Google make a lot of money, is basically on the distribution of data. Data analysis and the opportunity to do derivative products. For instance, we're working with a fire company in Montana, and they're putting cameras and they're putting a sensor array on the bottom of the aircraft, and when they're making passes and they're slurry bombers, when they're dropping water or they're dropping retardants on a fire, they're collecting data through the whole flight, and that data then can be reused to create simulations by the department, or can be used also for the city to find out about runoffs, water bleeds, everything that happens after a fire disaster. And that data program, that those data thought process, that leads us into disaster intelligence. And I think that's going to be a term that's used, you know, nationwide, if not internationally, because it's going to be such an important thing. As we become more and more intelligent, as we capture more and more data, it puts us in a position to be able to understand fires immediately, to understand disasters immediately. I mean, I come from Tornado Alley. I lived in Indiana originally, and the Midwest, and, you know, we didn't know what was happening with a tornado. There was a siren come off, and all of a sudden your house was gone. And so the data that we're gonna be able to collect during that, all those events is really gonna help overall these departments do very, very important things. The fire intelligence obviously is one of the most important because we immediately get situational awareness, and then that product becomes of other use. Search and rescue, we can save lives that we've never been able to do before with these little drones, which the deployment is fantastic, that's moving along. And of course, first response, like I talked about, where there's an opportunity to, you know, have people come and help. These are just a few of the, you know, advantages, that the competitive advantages that you get of this product versus not having airborne data acquisition. Blended communications like there's never been before. I went to a fire on a place called Happy River. It's in Australia, I mean it's in Alaska. And that fire was real intense, and that was the first time drones were used. And they got, that fire team were getting information by phone calls from citizens saying, yeah, the fire's coming up the canyon. And they would try to quickly lay it out on a map and figure out where it was. It was crazy, given that the ability for us to be able to repurpose data now. And so I see that as being an incredibly important tool as we move forward. And of course, the software and hardware updates improve team performance and everything else that comes out of those programs. This is just three simple examples. We have in the highest image there, we are able to look at fire and fuel. Through just video, we can see where there's fuel allotments of large amounts of fuel density, which makes it much safer when you're trying to fire a fire. You don't send guys in an area where you know there's fuel density, because there's a chance that they're not going to get out of there. It's going to be real dangerous for them. And then the topographic piece is where we really look at topomatics, and we see the elevations of the ground, so we can understand how hard it's going to be to traverse that area if we send some fire people in that area. And then the disaster simulation after the event, where maybe you lose homes or you lose businesses or whatever, and you want to understand how you're going to move forward the next time around for a better outcome. This is a really good thing that we said to the mayor. There's a political issue about everyone was worried about drones and being, you know, flying and privacy and, oh gosh, this drone's going to fly into my backyard, it's going to see me, and it's... Those are mostly commercial drones. We explained to them that the drones that we're talking about have no eyes. They're basically GPS gets them there and ground radar gets them there, gives them altitudes, and gives them position, gives them everything else. So we don't need to have cameras on them. The only cameras that we're gonna have is cameras for thermography, GIS. The things that we're gonna do when we show up at a fire won't use normal viewing. This is a real eye opener that we were able to explain to the fire chief, is that in the next 10 years as drones are deployed into the Los Angeles Fire group, we feel that we'll be able to have about 83,000 flights. But what we'll really be able to do is eliminate about 17,800 trucks showing up on a call. And that represents about $135 million. So you can see this, they can see that the cost savings is enormous, and the vehicle itself can get on scene much faster than they ever can in the traffic in Los Angeles. This gives you an idea of the size of the data files that are going to start being used and we're going to start receiving over the next few years. Right now we're able to punch in a cloud somewhere, in an internet cloud, we look at, you know, thermography data, and the files are generally about 10.6 gigabits, somewhere around there, for a fire event, if it was a one-day event. And then by 2022 or so, we'll be in the 532 gigabit area. And the reason why it's going up all the time is because all of you and all of the other engineers in the world are beginning to use that data and understand how that data can be applied and how important it is. And so we're gonna ask for more and more things. In that cycle, where we have thermography and we have geotropic. So, and then when we move out to 2030, we're going to be at 1.9 terabits. And that's when we really figured out how to apply what we've learned and use that data in a lot of different ways to make an incredibly smart city, and that our movement going forward, we should be able to reduce fires. We're not going to be able to, you know, change our environment, so we have to change our performance of firefighting in that environment. This gives you a little idea of the timeline and how long a timeline. This is about a 2-year timeline to deploy the drones that we're working with the fire department now. So it's nothing that we can get done tomorrow, and it really doesn't have, we're not hamstrung by the FAA anymore. The FAA is absolutely doing everything they can. They're in a terrible spot, because if they've done an incredible job, and you think about how many people fly every day now. I mean, there's millions of people who fly, and they keep us all safe. And, you know, we have very, very few accidents. So, I mean, they're doing an incredible job. And so it's tough where they are right now with little drones, because a lot of people aren't paying attention to just using their head and being safe. So that gives you a little bit of information about, you know, firefighting and what all that's about. And this is a program that is deep in my heart that we're working on right now, and it's our unmanned aerial cargo program. Aerial cargo can be this big, or it can be the size of a full-size airplane. Fred Smith, who owns Federal Express, is now working with Boeing and the U.S. Air Force to create a full-size flying wing, much like what Northrop created, except it's even larger, because that is the most universal design that you can put a lot of packages in. I wouldn't have thought that, but that's what they tell me. And so he's doing that, one of those aircraft to fly across the oceans. It costs about 36% less to build a UAV than it does a manned aircraft. Reason why is because you don't have to have any life support, and you don't have to have any insulation in the walls unless you have goods in there that could, if they're frozen, it would be bad on them. So it's definitely an important thing for commerce to move ahead. What we did is we designed a program that would truly be a real and important test between two hubs in America. In California, one of the largest hubs, and you folks know when you drive out towards Ontario or San Bernardino, you see these huge buildings, these giant logistics buildings everywhere. Those logistics buildings, there's about 735 million square feet under roof in that area, in that region. That's a lot. And they're moving God knows how many products every day, every hour, and what's going on. So what we did is we located at the International, at San Bernardino International Airport, we located our business for this project to fly back and forth across the United States with no one inside. And then we went to Ohio, and with our partners, St. Clair University in Ohio, we put another program in Wilmington. Now, we've gotten the COAs approved for both of those locations, the certificates of authorizations for both of those locations, and we're planning on doing the first unmanned full-scale flight in probably the next year. We've already flown the aircraft around the airport, we've done some other things, and we're moving forward. This is a sky version of the airport at San Bernardino. It used to be called Norton Air Force Base, and the Air Force Base moved out in 1996, and the city took it over, and they remodeled it, they put a bunch of money in it, and it really hasn't gone a lot of places, but there's been, you know, Amazon is there now, a lot of other large companies who are dealing with and moving packaging around. So this is our little airplane before we got involved in it in 2009, its maiden flight, and since then it's been flown about six times, and we're setting it up now to prepare it to fly much larger cross countries here in California, and then slowly but surely moving so where we can fly it across America with no one inside. Our control system, strangely enough, is designed and built using the basic telemetry and the basic components that are off-shelf components for for existing autopilot programs. And we're building a different controller system right now But actually, the controller system that existed for the autopilot was really pretty good. Radar altimeter was one of the best we could find. So there was a lot of really, really important things that we didn't really have to do. A lot of it was just off shelf. And this is the aircraft. You can see here the aircraft having a successful landing. And as we're showing here, that it's a Cessna Skywagon. We show here the aircraft coming in and landing on its maiden flight. And it was a pretty amazing thing. So now I'd like to talk a little bit about the FAA. Because I kept this one page for it, because all that at the top, that chaos at the top, are all kind of the terms and the acronyms that are used for God knows a million different things in the FAA, plus there's probably thousands more, because it's they've been a cross between the military and a cross between commercial use for so long. What the FAA is now doing is they have moved fast, although they were originally supposed to, for 2015, they were supposed to launch and have full integration and completion of drones into the commercial airspace or into the NAS by September of 2015. They missed that date. So it looks like in July this year, that's going to happen. We're very close now with the FAA. We're fortunate enough to get to talk to them a lot. They're definitely doing everything they can do to perform to make sure that they launch the program. And what the program is based on is the Part 107. And the Part 107, inside of that new package is a new, that new rule is a list of products that have to do with flight, commercial flight, and etc. So I'm more than willing to, this is a kind of a boring subject, so if anybody wants to talk to me about it afterwards, that'd be great. This is the future of UAS. I've actually seen this vehicle up close. This is a human drone. You can jump inside this thing if you're really light, and you can fly across the sky, I guess. It's just a simple drone. It has a simple drone concept. It uses a controller from a DJI aircraft, so it's another Arduino controller. And this is an aircraft that we're doing right now with Spectrum Aviation, where it is used to be a business jet. We're actually doing this with Linden Blue, and this will be a great aircraft too, that will be full of goods and fly from coast to coast in about 3 hours. And then, of course, this is a future transportation where we have one of these vehicles, and that's the thing we're really doing with drones. More than anything, what we're doing with drones is we're laying the footprint with drones to be able to fly in cities and make the real superhighways of the future. And those real superhighways of the future are going to be, governments can no longer afford to build infrastructure. We can't ask them to build another 405. It wouldn't work anyway. We know that. And so the thing's going to happen is we're going to have $300,000 Teslas that fly above all the traffic, and you'll be able to buy one. And it won't be any real infrastructure, because we're building all that infrastructure right now, that digital infrastructure. That's what we're doing every day when we fly in a drone. And then this is a really important shot I thought I'd show you guys. This is a starfighter, actually, in 1945, that crashed on a ship in the Pacific. No, not really. Just had to throw that in so you guys can have a laugh. I thought that was a great picture. That's a real drone there. Any questions?
I want to relate to every piece of that talk. So So as I said, today we'll talk about area of home, but to put things into perspective, I will start from my involvement with flight control technology, going into the history of flight control. So we got some of it here already in the first talk. And the main driver of our research was the certification challenge of flight control systems, advanced flight control systems. I will talk about some work with the transition to NASA, USA, Air Force, and other industries. A little bit we'll talk about top rocket control of unmanned aerial vehicles in the uncontrolled airspace. I'll describe a little bit what is uncontrolled airspace. And opportunities in commercial sector, like we heard recently about firefighters, about some other applications that we're involved with, and also interaction of humans with flying robots, where we integrate already research from computer science, psychology, data science, and so on. So here are the examples of aerial core robots that some of you have seen already. So this would be kind of a surveillance machine that would do surveillance. This would capture data from your farms to help you get actionable insights. This is Amazon Prime aerial delivery drone that we have seen. This is a type of vehicle that will work at NASA for aerial sampling. And what you see here is basically a drone reduced to wearable technologies. It's an easy drone that can fly and take a small selfie. And this is a snapshot from the New York Times article that were there where we developed kind of a drone for domestic use to help elderly with daily tasks. So to give a brief background on my kind of pedigree, so I graduated from Yerevan State University in 1988, pursued my PhD in Moscow, spent a year and a half in Stuttgart University, Germany, here in France, and then in 1998 I came to Georgia Tech Atlanta. 2003 I went to Virginia Tech with a faculty job, and in 2008 I landed in University of Illinois, where I have been since then. So as I said, my work with flight control technology involves a historical event. So in 1967, in the kind of mid-50s, 60s, NASA launched its X-15 program, which is until now the most prominent flight test program at NASA. So the objective was to bridge the gap between the manned flight in atmosphere and the space flight by flying at altitudes about 30,500 meters at Mach numbers 4 to 6, and it was clear that a single gain flight controller would not suffice for the large envelope and all the variations. So people started testing adaptive controllers, and the first one ended up with a crash on November 15, 1967. As a later study at Honeywell figured out, it was due to the adaptive controller that went into saturation and led to the crash. Later, Carl Ostrom referred to that period as brave era, implying that there was a very short path from theory to practice. Today, if you decide to crash an airplane like this, it's simply impossible. It's pretty safe for that. That historical crash led to massive research in by mathematicians to establish the stability and robustness properties of flight controllers. And I won't go now through the details because I'm not in MIT or Berkeley. I'll just quickly jump saying that the historical developments along the theory line led to another landmark achievement. Exactly 30 years after that historical crash, United States Air Force, jointly with the Boeing Company, successfully flight tested the X-36 Thales unstable aircraft with an adaptive controller on board. Well, basically this flight test proved that there is no need to do wind tunnel testing for modeling the aerodynamic coefficients, with an estimate of which at Boeing will run it to $10 million. And instead one can use an adaptive flight controller that can compensate for the lack of knowledge of the aerodynamic coefficients, yet the benefit does not come for free. Basically, on one hand, one saves all the wind tunnel testing, on the other hand, one has to build up massive Monte Carlo simulations to figure out the best adaptive gain for every flight condition, for every uncertainty. Basically, the price of the software development was growing on the other end. So a fundamental question that came up, so how to design adaptive flight control systems that would be captured, that would be capable of adapting fast without losing robustness, right? The JNM example you see here is by Air Force production, so it basically uses an adaptive controller developed by our group at Georgia Tech. But the fundamental question that came up basically is what drove our research over at Virginia Tech. So we came up with the so-called L1 adaptive control architecture. L1 stands for a special norm in a specific space. So the key idea here is the decoupling of the estimation and control loops. So we were able over the years to commercialize it for different industries. What you see here is the Raymarine Evolution Autopilot, Intellinair drone, Caterpillar, Stardust. We had lots of intensive testing. So So more details are in our book. So, and with this architecture, we were able already to tackle major challenges in different industries. So the underlying mathematical problem is used to is reduced to some non-convex optimization problems, and I won't go into the details of solutions of this. So just putting things into the historical context, and this slide has been adapted from the Boeing company. So about starting 60s, as I said, until 2005, Boeing was able to transition adaptive control to various platforms through various programs. Everywhere they were limited by the slow pace of adaptation, expensive gain scheduling, so we came up with a fast adaptation with single design, and we were able to take a few major airplanes. Here what you see is the UAV platform of Naval Force Graduate School. Here is a subscale 757 at NASA we did, and the other one is the Learjet that we flew, and I will go through some flight tests just to keep things more entertaining. So in 2007, NASA came up with this aviation safety program from US Congress, where the challenge was to ensure that the flight control system would be always predictable, repeatable, testable, safe. The four buzzwords were put forth. What you see here in green is the normal flight envelope, where the airplane will, the pilot will usually fly. The gray corresponds to the flight envelope that one can have from wind tunnel data. In the blue area, it's not clear whether the airplane is controllable or not. The best example I give to illustrate this is my car accident in Illinois during the first winter when I moved. So basically, I had no experience of driving on ice, and the first ice storm hit, and I had a car accident because I didn't know how to handle my car in unpredictable circumstances. So in unpredictable circumstances, you tend to provide overcorrective actions, and that can cause basically an accident, but as you see, I'm alive. When that happened on an airplane, I was driving at 5 miles per hour, so I couldn't have died. But if it happens with an airplane and the pilot tries to provide the corrective action, he ends up with so-called pilot-induced oscillations, which is the main cause of aviation crash. So in the blue area, in terms of angle of attack and side slip, it's not clear if the airplane is controllable or not. These are the conditions that for which you can try maybe to train the pilots to fly there. But you don't want the safety of the aircraft to depend upon the skill level of the pilot. You want it always to be predictable, testable, safe, and repeatable, right? So NASA said, can we come up with a flight control system that will take large class of uncertainties and yet provide a controllable aircraft to the pilot? So NASA came with a serious commitment, kind of. They built this subscale aircraft, which was 5.5% geometrically and dynamically scaled model. I think they paid $1 million to Boeing to get the aerodynamic database. And they spent 5 years on correctly downscaling. They even did not want to include a small computer board on it because it would have violated the mass scaling property. And I mean, through a major competitive program, we were awarded about $1.5 million to test our controller on it. So, I mean, the key idea here was to build a flying wind tunnel. Why flying wind tunnel? Because when Boeing tests advanced aircraft, advanced control methodologies or anything, they have to go through wind tunnel to reach the real airplane. And despite all the advancements, from wind tunnel to real airplane, a flight controller is not moving. So 50 years, they are still using the controllers from 50. So the credibility level is not enough, the fidelity level is not enough. So NASA said we'll build a flying wind tunnel, by which they meant that they will have a pilot on the ground flying the subscale airplane, which will be a one level higher fidelity as compared to the wind tunnel. So they built this subscale model, provided it to all the researchers who were part of that program, including the Boeing company. So everybody got the same 4-degree angle of attack, 18 knot equivalent airspeed flight condition to design their controller, and the pilots were going to test it to put it into various challenging conditions to see how the flight control system could handle it. So, the program was very exciting being a part of it, but it was challenging. 6 a.m. there, 8 p.m. out of the runway, all day without bathroom. So it was really, it was part of the challenges, right? So these runways, so, I mean, we're spending 2 weeks there just to make sure we get the fair chance of fair competition. So the airplane is being taken off by the safety pilot, who then handles the controls to the research pilot. The research pilot has 40 years of experience as a Boeing pilot and is now working as a research pilot for NASA. So he speaks pretty well our language. Like, he would come and say, oh, I had more damping here, or I want more kind of aggressive maneuver. And he was able to spell out everything in terms of control specifications. spacious. So here is where I got first time exposed to really rigorous engineering. We had a 700-page book by NASA provided for all the specs that we had to watch out, to kind of be very conservative in testing every new condition. So here is the mobile operation station inside which we had three rooms. This is the pilot next to him, is a flight test engineer who is capable of injecting failures on the airplane. And the pilot is testing and just giving rankings to the controller. And I will go through some of the rankings as well. So what was also important through this testing, NASA was trying to collect more data, as the role of the data was emphasized here. So the more data was giving opportunity to update the aerodynamic models and to have better fidelity, higher fidelity models for various challenging conditions that the aircraft was going to test. And now you will see that system identification group that's recording actively the data, because I mean, the data is what makes it all the research by the end of the day valuable. So this is the pilot station. Next to him are the system ID group people. So here we are, the system identification people on the last room. In the last room we were sitting with muted microphones, so we could hear the pilot talking, but we couldn't basically talk or comment. And so just coming to land. So they had also outside crew. There were about 20 people from NASA. So some were working outside, some inside. Every flight was 14 minutes, taking 4 hours. There was 1.5 hour pre-flight check, 15 minutes flight, 2 hours post-flight briefing. So everything had to go according to specific protocol, right? And with that, so I will just go. So this is my student and postdoc with whom we work. So, I mean, they were putting it into various conditions. For example, this is like a post-stall flight when they were trying to put the aircraft into stall. When the aircraft goes into stall, it loses lift and it goes into rolling stability and crashes. This is like my crash with the car accident. So, and if you hear two pilots' conversation, they are trying three different strategies. It's like you pull your car up an icy mountain and you can't pull you back up, and then you try faster, slower. If you tune to pilots' conversation, when they are trying it, you will hear that they are trying three different strategies. So this is the first one. So they go to 18, and they so then they try 16 or 15, then they try faster. He says, let's try faster this time. Pay attention, this is flight 25. In flight 23, they had first time tried our controller, and after flight 23, when the controller worked, so NASA was challenging everybody, professors, pilots. So when in flight 23 they tried us, and it's coming up towards the end, then they go to flight 25 and they force the pilots to repeat to see whether they have learned something from it or not. Like from my car accident, I learned that I never had a car accident again. But they couldn't learn, basically. That was the proof that in flight 25, without our controller, they were crashing. Now they will go. So now they tried once, so they didn't crash. Now they go the second time to repeat it. And the point of repeating is that to make sure they get repeatable, testable results, because repeatability and testability is critical for certification. You can be stable 100 times, but if your transients are different, they are again handling it very well. If your transients are different, you just can't be certified. Okay, says certification can't go to repeatability, testability. And here we see that even the oscillations and the stall condition were very repeatable. This is when they pulled the aircraft to the departure rate of the flight envelope to test how much of variation it can handle. And as I said, while the controller was designed for 4 degree angle of attack, they go up to 28, the departure rate of the flight envelope, and that's where they kind of gather flight data regarding the crash conditions. So to make sure, and then when they go there, they do a lot of system identification tasks by injecting Schroeder sweeps, if you're familiar with aerospace language. So they excite the system to get the parameters identified, right? Here is where they hold. Beyond 12 degree angle of attack, this aircraft is installed up to from 750 to 53 up to 770. Holding the aircraft at the departure range for this much, it wasn't ever done, and the flight data they collect helps them to kind of model the envelope for wider conditions, right? So we got a special issue article in IEEE's Control Systems magazine on safety critical control. So the whole article magazine was issued to us. So we basically demonstrated that with a single flight condition designed controller, we could go to the departure rate of the flight envelope, and this was the only controller cleared by the pilot for postal flight conditions. And it helped the system ID group to do modeling around steady aerodynamics at stall. And this got us into Flight International, some media attention, so outside the box, so they were referring to this mobile operation station overall, like an outside, thinking outside the box concept, and here was a nice commentary by the journalist regarding our group and our controller. So NASA is pushing this further. So after flying the 5.5%, we're flying the 15% now. We have the GL-10, which is a hybrid vehicle. You can think of it as a hybrid drone. So it has vertical takeoff and landing capabilities. At the same time, the wings rotate for forward flight, and it gives you flight endurance longer. If the drones are limited by 40 minutes battery time, this way we can fly longer and still have the agility from drones combined with the long endurance flight of fixed-wing UAVs. We have full-scale simulator, and eventually last year we got an opportunity to fly the Learjet at Edwards Air Force Base here, not far in Lancaster. So this is already a real one, it is not a subscale. It gives us a lot more challenging flight conditions. If the subscale airplane was flying at 80 knots equivalent airspeed condition, here we were at 250 equivalent air knot speed condition, and two flight conditions were given for us to test. We had 20 hours of flight, so here is what you see inside the airplane. We had five people, the flight test engineer was recording here the data. And this is one of the typical conditions that's called 800 air. Saber dance is a well-known accident, so it happens at low altitude, low speed conditions. When the airplane, during the takeoff, loses the speed and then it crashes, it cannot basically generate lift. So we were very happy, lucky, fortunate, I don't know which word to use, that Edwards Air Force Base approved 7 failure configurations, including this one, to put our controller at test. And I mean, these airplanes are kind of like the driving school cars that have a way of safety controller to override in case something goes wrong, but there is still a risk, right? So we were lucky, so they let us test. And here is one of the movies. It's recorded from inside the airplane. I mean, getting two airplanes chase each other, first of all, would be too expensive. That's how the beautiful movies you see online. But from even inside the airplane, you hear two pilots' conversation when let me just interrupt for a minute, explain what's happening. So when you're flying in the airplane and there is no fasten seatbelt sign, that's called level one flying qualities one, right? So when it starts a little bit shaking, it's called already level two, level three, so it's degradation. So the higher the number, the poorer the flying qualities, the faster seatbelt signs and so on. So When they are flying, pilots are giving rankings always to the performance of the controller, right? They say Cooper Harper rating 1, 2, 3, 4, and there is an engineer who sits there and records all their comments. So basically what happens here, the pilot has to give ranking because L1 is turned off, the airplane is put into accident. So the pilot has to give ranking so that when they turn on the L1, so he can change his ranking and we see how much we improve. So here it's so slippery that he's not able to read even the scoring sheet to give the ranking. He asks, so turn on L1 so that we get the ranking down. So just, it's scripted, you can work. And the oscillations you see I hit from here, the light shaking, it's the level of oscillations for you as an indicator here. Otherwise there's no way to show it. Their master thesis basically, and one of my former students is a test pilot school instructor who gives me this opportunity for the new pilots to get trained on our methods to get their pilot license. Basically, it's all about connections, right? Whom you know where. So, then another one is the landing. So, we go even for landing with L10, which is also another challenging. If you ask the pilots flying airplanes, it's all about takeoff and landing, and landing is being more challenging. And now you will hear them saying uneventful. They count already altitude, they are coming down. Uneventful, so that was the point. So, and we got into Aviation Week. Basically, Aviation Week came to Edwards Air Force Base and we got interviewed there, so basically we were highlighted, right? So here is our Intelliner drone. So we'll show you what our company does, you can see. So this is like kind of taking the base autopilot from a third party company and putting our controller on it to show how much more uncertainty it can handle. So if you look here, so it's a missing propeller, no GPS. So the propeller is missing, and we are flying with a missing propeller, and we are able to do position hold and stabilize the aircraft despite the fact that one propeller is missing. Yeah. And when it, comes down, then they do. So this is going back to the base autopilot of this third party company. I won't give the company's name, and so let it kind of be ethical to others. So, and now you'll see that without our controller, it basically cannot take off, right? So flight control was not invented by us, we just make it safer and better, right? And the next one will have this off-balance bottle hanging. This bottle is filled with water, I think it's half filled with water. And they will take off and stabilize. Right.
Wow.
Right. So, wow. Right. It's a wow.
Yeah, I know what that is. Yeah, that's good.
So, and if we take off the bottle, it will go on crash, right? And not the bottle. If we kind of put off the other controller, it's base product, right? It had a base product here. So it's very stable landing with that bottle hanging. And now back to its base PID controller that they usually all these off-the-shelf autopilots come with. And that bottle will throw it off, not letting it fly, right? So what else have we done with drones? This is just to show an autopilot development, right? So I mean, here are lots of other kind of movies that I won't go, like surveillance movies. For example, we can show this one. you can see how it takes them. This one may not be that interesting handwriting. So it will go into free falls, right? It goes up and down, free falls without ground effects, without the stabilization. You will see now how it goes. Without destabilization, right? It comes, hits the ground, but without losing it, and then it goes into position hold. And also here it's a position hold kind of picture. I mean, these movies are too many, and I can show you like examining a light in the street. This is flying quite high wings. It gets very close to lamp, to the very close examination of it, right? Basically. I want to jump over this move and go to more substance, right? This is developing pilot interfaces for, like, situation awareness was raised here.
Our work. A
purpose of this is that, say, if we have this super robust controller that saves the airplane from crashing, by the time the pilot figures out that something is happening, it would be too late to save, right? Say the wind gets blown off and we are flying super robust, the pilot has no clue what's happening, right? And by then it crashes, there's no time for emergency landing. This way we give him additional display to get an idea of what's happening. This is our next airplane, we'll be flying it in September. It's supersonic flight, F-16, it's super exciting, we're super excited. We'll fly it in September, I can talk about it next time I am here. This is our working cooperative control when we're flying two UAVs with heterogeneous cameras, trying to maximize the overlap of the field of view for target tracking problems, a Navy-funded project, fixed-wing UAVs. The glider you see here was deployed as an additional antenna to extend the communication range, to extend the coverage of the area. So it was flown back in 2010 or 11. So the two cameras, one is kind of single degree freedom, high resolution, that UAV flies higher, the other one low altitude, multi-degree freedom, two-degree freedom gimbal, and trying to capture bigger area, but with low resolution. Then through communication, they share the information to optimize the objective. This is our work related to integration of UAVs into national airspace, the uncontrolled airspace, where basically the UAVs will be flying, and the air traffic control system has no control over it. So you need to have really communication protocols, how to exchange information, how to manage their trajectories and the confliction and everything. So that's very challenging and very interesting. So all of this is important because already life has proven that if you lose one big vehicle to accomplish one big mission, then you can lose that vehicle from a small accident, then your multi-billion dollar program is gone, as the two major programs prove. So you instead deploy a bunch of small UAVs, and small UAVs do not have big payload, but they can exchange information, and through communication they can accomplish the same big mission. And if you use one vehicle from a network of vehicles, then the remaining set of the vehicles can emerge and accomplish the vision, right? So in the framework of cooperative control, so there are also a few ideas about how to generate the trajectories cooperatively in a distributed manner, how to achieve the coordination. So the key idea comes to decoupling of space and time. So basically how to make it all happen. So here is the basic architecture. And here is kind of that movie that I was right now talking about. This was accomplished by Navy, so we got kind of good funding to go to Camp Robert with the UAVs of Naval Board Graduate School. I just need maybe 5-10 more minutes and I will be done. I'll show a few more use of UAVs for various commercial applications. So two UAVs are flying, scanning the area, and very soon you will see that their cameras point to maximize the overlap of the field of view so that to improve the probability of finding the mobile target on that road, right? And then these are the key ideas come from, we use Bezier curves, geometrical separation of the space. This is like they fly coordinatedly, achieving kind of simultaneously the end, right? Right, so basically there are different cooperative missions here that you can see that they coordinate, so I will just jump ahead. This is already going into a little bit making it fancy how they can dance, so we got some competitions winning here, but this is just simulating and then going into the real, repeating the same dance. Of drones, this is like to engage students into the lab and to teach them simultaneously different, the role of different sciences, right? Graph theory is used for communication, Lyapunov stability for stability, robustness is achieved through different things, so they have collision avoidance here and different types of maneuvers that you will see. And going a little bit more towards the kind of, I mean, this is like the whole point of showing this is this, right? So you watch this swarm of vehicles flying, avoiding collisions, and birds, right? They avoid collisions, they avoid crashes, they it's an urban environment, it's trees, I mean, everything is done safely and kind of they don't hurt each other. An equivalent of this, so why did I put this here, right? So what is happening here is really sophisticated sensing, actuation, coordination, communication without any crashes. And the analog of it is the orchestra, right? And this is like, so this is my phantom of opera, I say. If you look into an orchestra, nobody watches the conductor. Really, people watch their nose, right? But they all feel and sense each other, right? This is control technology. This is what control technology can deliver to you. Sophisticated sensing and actuation. Right? None of them watches at the conductor if you watch. Everybody watches their note. But they feel and sense. One of them hears four musicians, the other may hear 10 musicians, right? There is this sophisticated sensing and actuation in our bodies. If we have the talent for music, we are going and playing, and the artistic performance comes out, and that there is no kind of big deal that I'm putting these two pictures together and running. This is what control technology can deliver, okay? If you do it well and properly. And this is what, like, an experiment we did for firefighters, that it was well explained that instead of sending the firefighter over this truck to the roof inspection, we'll fly the drone, because for it's estimated, I think, that a fire, from fire alarm 9/11, it takes 4 minutes for the fire truck to reach the fire site. And then, look, the firefighter has to climb that thing on the roof. Instead, this drone, with a push of a button, if it's autonomous from your office, can go into the roof inspection. You are building situation awareness, and by building situation awareness, you will already direct your firefighters' human resources in a more optimized way, right? So this will, I can bring it here, and then you will see it goes through roof inspection, and kind of, it can get very close to certain areas, so it can give you a clear idea of what's happening. The other one is a car accident site, that it goes and reads the car tag from the accident, and shows you basically what type of chemical is there, whether it can hurt or not. I'm finishing, but it's all interesting. People will have questions. So I can decide that it's over. Well, I can finish it and see, but there are a few interesting things that you finish it, right? So it comes to the car to read the chemicals, to understand whether it's now it will go close to read the chemical, and you can determine in your office whether this car is explosive or not, to send the human being there or to save the human being, because if it explodes, then you lose human lives, right? So you can basically see what type of commercial applications you can achieve, right? And then this is the agriculture, I will just jump over it. And this is what got us into New York Times, basically. As I said, if drones are reduced to wearable technology, we thought of using drones for pill delivery, for example, right? So you can get your medicine reminder on your iPhone, you can push a button, a pill delivery simple drone, which is the size of my palm, can go to a dispenser, get the pill and bring it to you, right? It's maybe very futuristic, but basically this is where we integrate research from psychology, human factors, to develop drones that can be applicable for domestic use, right? And here he gets his pill and takes it out and sleeps. And this project was funded by NSF for $1.5 million, and it kind of basically put us into New York Times. I'll go over it. So to test this type of research, we go through virtual reality environment, and I won't run these movies, okay? I got all the science that this is like a quote that I like to bring up here. The student asks Professor Einstein, are the questions of this year's exam the same as last year? Yes, the answers are different today. And the answers are different today, we know why. So this got us into New York Times. This is the package delivery of Amazon, so I won't go here. We got another project from NSF to study how the society would be impacted when Amazon starts delivering your packages to your door. And we have a few nice movies here that I'm skipping because I got all kinds of... Oh, this is the cybersecurity. Let me just show that. If you try to hack a drone software, how to make it cyber secure against viruses. So here is a flight, just I'll just come to the movie. So it flies, and you try to hack the software of it, you cannot, because we have already a cybersecurity protection system. It's a patented technology, it's also a big file for a patent, so basically, he's issuing the tag, and we see how it's safe from that. Now he issues the tag, and we're kind of basically safe. Right, so the tag couldn't kill it, right? So, but I'll just stop here. Okay, I don't have
how
to go.
How long was the Amazon one?
Oh, the movie. Well, you see, there are if you have questions, I can go back to all the movies, but I'm getting all the signs that I have to stop. So I'll just stop here. So questions I want to ask.
I know it's an exciting topic, but we also have a time limitations here, and there's a certain time that we have to be out of here, and I know there are a lot of people have questions. So I like to, I know it's very exciting, I was kind of excited to see the movies, but sorry, we have to, we have a time limitation here with the facility, we have gives us a certain limitation. So we need to abide by the limitations. So we'll start taking questions, and both of our speakers can answer the question, depending to what the question is, I'm sure they can.
Right. Okay. The time that the email came out that there's this lecture series about drones, it was just during the Darapa war that we heard that drones were delivering bombs. So I guess that would be some military application, but similar to somebody sitting somewhere and sending a bomb somewhere and exploding on a certain target where the GPS would be, I guess, in the system somewhere.
So what's the question?
The question is, I mean, about this, how is the technology, you said it's not hack-proof, but then would that be safe to assume that we know? If you see a drone coming towards you with a bomb, I mean, can you stop
it?
Can you stop it or pop it in the air somehow?
Certainly, for every anti-hack, there is another hack, right? So the guy who fixed this for us, he's one of those guys who knows how to hack everything. And he was impressed how we developed a solution that could prevent it against the hack. Right? So, I mean, for every equation, there is an anti-equation, I say. It's doable, right? So, okay, go ahead.
Second.
Yes,
I have two questions.
Okay.
Do you have a book on your control system?
Yes, sure.
Or do you have them available here?
No, not with
okay,
me,
the
sorry.
Second question, how long do these small drones last? I mean, if you let them run forever, do they die in 1 day, 1 minute, 1 hour?
Well, the
do they wear out?
Well, the battery life is limited. Well, the small one that's delivering pills in our lab, the battery life is 7 minutes.
7 minutes?
Right, the one in our lab, the small one, it's palm size,
oh,
right?
Okay.
It's palm
Amazon's.
Size. No, Amazon will have 45 minutes or even more. I mean, it depends how you build it. If they build it hybrid, they can benefit from fixing, I mean, right.
They're all different times.
Right, they're all different times.
Because the battery life has different chemistry in it, and each battery is either better or worse.
And if one of the rotors fails, what happens? That's what I'm...
Well, you just saw they built a stabilization system, so if one of the rotors failed, it wouldn't mean anything.
No, I mean, it depends what type of failure. You are not failure-proof against everything, right? But to the extent that at least your flight control system can provide you robust, so the type of car accident I can avoid, right, for example, I mean, unpredictable circumstances, predictable responses.
Yeah, I have two questions, too. One is that are these drones or the drone technology weatherproof now? They have all weather drones or...
So you mean in rain and
rain,
right.
Wind, snow?
The ones that I showed maybe not, but I'm sure there are commercial products that would be weatherproof, right?
Yeah, we've
not ours.
We've tested two of them right now that are weatherproof, that are full weather drones.
And night and day.
There it is, right there. They didn't fly any time, and the FAA has just opened it up so that you can get clearance for flying at night based on the telemetry of the drone.
Are these like commercial drones that...
The commercial vehicles, yep.
Yeah.
You can buy them there from, I think they're $3,000.
Okay. The other question I have is that, what is it that you guys, I don't want to say wanted, or maybe you were expecting in return? I mean, are you proposing a software?
Me?
A technology?
She's proposing software.
I'm graduating students who go and transform the industry.
you're just giving up information. You're not selling anything. Or
no, I'm not.
No, but if you want to buy it, I'm sure we put a price on it.
What do you want to buy? Science? Go to University of Illinois IP office.
Hi, thank you. I guess this question's for Mr. Cashin. You did a great presentation on, obviously, the technology, the safety, the anti-hacking that can come. But one question, a couple of years ago, Jeff Bezos from Amazon gave a whole presentation on how packages can be delivered in urban areas,
right,
avoiding traffic, blah, blah, blah. Also now moving humans, where you and I sitting in a drone, we're not the driver, we're the passenger.
That's
in
right.
An unmanned drone where it's all technology controlled and gets you from point A to point B, and all that's great. The question I have, which you didn't talk about, is the traffic issues, the air traffic issues that come to play, and also the safety, not necessarily from the technology, but from interceptors, people shooting them down, people intercepting and wanting to steal what is in that. Can you talk about that a little bit?
I think that Maria basically did a great job pointing out how they're building an adaptive system that works with in concert with the flight controller to improve the flight dynamics completely. So in the event that someone shot at you, let's just say something horrible like that happened, and you were to lose a rotor, maybe her system would adapt for that and keep the airplane flying, or the vehicle, or rather, flying until it landed on the ground. We're not sure of all the configurations, you know, the topologies of the vehicles will have either four propellers, or I don't really look for them to have too many propellers, they'll probably have more fans as they get to where we start setting inside them. But, you know, I mean, there's only so many provisions you can make for it. It's just like if you're driving a car down the road and somebody's on a bridge and they throw a rock in your windshield, what are you going to do? You know, and so it's a lot that same way, is that the vehicles can't really adapt for ground fire. You know, it's just, they're just there to take people where they want to go.
In the 5.5% model that you were testing with, how did the pilots get a control feedback? How did they know that they were violating the envelope?
How did they know that they were not violating the envelope? They were sitting in that mobile operation station with the same display that they would have had on a Boeing game.
And there's feedback.
They were
in the
flying,
system.
Right. The feedback, the loop is
shaken.
So the airplane did have sensors send feedback
right.
to the controls.
Right, so the entire control system is closed on the ground with the pilot.
Yeah.
With the only difference that when he flies, he sees everything, but the thing is flying there, the real one. And it's one level higher fidelity as compared to the wind tunnel, giving us more hope that conservative Boeing commercial can pay attention to it, because whatever is happening in wind tunnel does not make its way to the real airplane. So until now it's flying with the controllers from 50s and 60s. I don't think that Boeing will go and take it, but if they put it as a backup flight control system, they will win for sure, right? In case of bad accident, it kicks in and saves. Right?
But there's no feedback from the vehicle itself. It's only filtering that happens inside the building.
Yeah.
You know, there's nothing, it just knows it's in that envelope. The aircraft's doing this thing, and sensors tell it, and the feedback starts, you know, at the pilot's seat.
But with the Learjet and kind of this F-16, that's always the real airplane, the real part. F-16 will fly this fall. It's a lot more challenging airplane, a lot more prestigious, a lot more expensive to operate. So they gave us first the Learjet. And aerospace industry, the most conservative industry. I mean, the next time we'll get a chance to fly something more challenging. I don't know, but I know that Edwards Air Force Base will give us Learjet and F-16 every year to fly now, Ultra. Okay, go ahead.
You hear Amazon investing resources on the drones. Just curious about the delivery companies like FedEx, UPS, or...
I think they're also jumping on. They're also investing in this direction. I have heard that they're investing.
Fred Smith doesn't believe in doing drone local delivery. I mean, he has the most things to win out of it, obviously, because Federal Express delivers a lot to door-to-door, but he doesn't believe in that. He's right now, he's very focused on international delivery, packaging up airplanes. He feels like that will be the best place for savings. He's afraid he'll lose too many assets in local, and it's because of a lot of reasons, because drones, you know, they really don't do that well and win with adopted technology. Has put together, you know, there's a good chance that they do a lot better than this, but.
You are comparing the PID control. Are you using Fuzzy logic?
No, we did not use Fuzzy logic. No, our adaptive is different, we're starting to use Fuzzy logic.
Back there?
So, what you were talking about, the drones with helping fire departments, are you currently working on projects that to fly drones within fires, that basically between flames, I guess. I know you have to worry about like insulation and all kinds of stuff.
Yeah.
Are there any projects?
Well, the ones that we proposed, I don't know.
No, you go.
The ones that we proposed are, we have two classes of drones. One's a highly designed, a drone that's highly designed, has a lot of sensor array on it, so it can do a lot of different things. And another one's a throwaway drone, because it's a lot more inexpensive to, you know, throw a $700 drone into a fire and get information from it than it is to throw a person into the fire. You know, firemen have typically, you know, bundled it up and ran into the fire. You know, I mean, that's a really true thing. When anytime you hear a fire truck, for the most part, these guys are brave people. They're going to a problem. You know, they're going to somewhere that's very dangerous. And so they want to have things like our drones to be able to throw them in there and get as much information as they can before it melts.
But not recovery.
No, it wouldn't be a recovery vehicle. The recovery vehicle is flying around the vicinity, doing all the other radiant type of temperatures and dealing with all that.
All right.
We'll have
Yes, sir.
You mentioned something about collaboration between the Boeing and FedEx.
Yes.
Right? Since I'm a FedEx retiree and he's a Boeing retiree, so just could you explain a little more?
Yeah, well, what happens is Boeing had a small aviation program, and a UAS program that ran for about 6.5 years. It started in 2000. And they did it, and it was underwritten, some of it was underwritten by Federal Express. I mean, Federal Express is their largest customer, and I mean, continuous customer. And so they did that program, they moved that program onto a 1/5 scale model, which is this flying wing thing. And that's what they're doing right now, to fly international flights with it, because it has, you know, best L over D in it.
Okay.
Natalie.
Yeah, like the weapons that are in regulation, is there a regulation for having, for general public, having a drone? And I heard that there might be, or anybody can buy anything they want.
You mean to control a weapons delivery or something?
No, just in the future.
Oh, just fly a drone. Well, right now, unfortunately, it's, you know, it's Katy bar the doors. It's what happened was it transitioned instantly from a toy to an aircraft. Like, you know, Dr. Herter said, who leads the FAA, his first words out of his mouth were to all these drone people at our event that we had last December was, "Welcome to the world of aviation," and he meant that. It was time to start, you know, tying people down and saying, can't fly around airports, you can't do these things, you can't, because he has to protect a lot of people every day. And so, I don't know if I answered your question, but that they haven't limited it yet for anyone to fly, I mean, to buy one of these things, and you don't have to go in with a certain piece of paper that says, I passed all these tests in order to buy this. They're not at that point yet, but God forbid an airplane gets lost or something, a passenger airplane gets lost, that may happen. But
they have to register.
We have to register. You go through a registration system, but the registration system really is more about you just saying, this is my name and this is where I live and I've got three of these things. It doesn't really take you into a process of learning, and that's what we're working with the FAA on right now to deploy. That will happen in June as a whole educational program, and that's where a new class of pilot will be called a drone pilot. And you'll have to get that license. It's about $150, it takes a ground school, it takes a practical, and it takes a written.
I have a question about the drones being hacked. Can you hack a drone?
Well, I showed you, right? You can hack and you can also prevent the hack. So there is a solution for that. I mean, basically what I was showing here is a kind of high performance controller with a high assurance controller. The high performance controller is RL1, and high assurance controller is something that will take over, because if somebody hacks, you have to reboot your system. Right, your software is hacked. The onboard autopilot that has the software, it has to be rebooted. During the rebooting, you have no feedback, right, basically, because the controller is in the computer. When you have no feedback, you need to have some type of behavior that guarantees you open loop stability. That's called high assurance controller. It does not have the performance of that safety controller that we had, but it has some sort of stable behavior. And there are some switching mechanisms, stability envelope computed here. It's kind of a few PhD dissertations have been written, right? And then you go and test and develop all that and so on. By the way, this solution that we're developing now, we have filed a patent through University of Illinois. The guy who does it, he's a hacker, he's doing all this. He says, within 5 years, 95% of drone companies in the world will be able to download it with one click and change their autopilot and have this protection. I mean, he's very passionate about it and driven to develop it. So, okay.
Yes.
Patented hacking. Okay. Once a hacking gets patented, then it's public.
No, it's not the hacking, it's the solution,
it's
to
the solution
against
the
hacking, not the hacking.
Yeah, the
it's this architecture, but without major details, right? So
yeah.
Basically, there is a little bit more here. So it's.
So you mean like there's a chance that a military drone can be hacked too?
Certainly, everything can be hacked. Everything can be hacked,
right?
But you need to be to have stable protection mechanism. It's like everything can be crashed, right? The cars are getting safer, the airplanes are getting safer, but it's never 100%, right? Are we now 100% safe in this building? You never know whether you'll get out from here safe or not. No, but I mean, that's the point. The point point is that you want 100% answer, then, oh, no, let me, okay, I didn't mean to overburden you.
What is the communication protocols used to talk to the drones? So if I,
oh, I passed this.
What is the most common?
Modeling, I think, or something. I'm not into that, okay? I can talk to others.
If you want, we can talk to them. It kind of goes on and on, so.
Wilhelm, you mentioned that you're working with the fire department, and you're planning to fly drones to the site. Are they flying by a user, or are they autonomous?
I'm sorry?
The drones that you're planning to fly
deploy
with the fire department, are they, there's a user flying them?
Yeah, they'll be RPS. They'll be remote-controlled aircraft. You know, we don't have enough data. Those big circles I showed you with data, we need to be in that middle one before we can be in a position to completely make them autonomous. I mean, if you ask somebody, they'll say it's autonomous, but the vehicles, as Maria showed, the most important thing is the self-awareness of the vehicle. She showed the birds and that there was a feeling and this symmetry between these machines. The self-healing, all of that data has to, you know, evolve, and it all has to be real. So in real-world situations, like when there's a 1,500-degree fire right next to you, that's a whole different set of circumstances.
One last question, yes,
please. So, as far as the firefighting drones go, are there any programs that are for larger scale fires, like residential or forest?
Well, right now, we're working with the forest fire folks, and we're trying to get, and this is kind of tough, we're trying to take all the slurry bombers and instrument those slurry bombers so we can start getting data. Again, it always goes back to data, so we can work with folks like, you know, like this University of Urbana and say, here's all our data, and this is what's happening. Give us some ideas to help us fly in this environment. Because there's so many different things happening. You have flare-ups, and you have different temperatures, and there's wind shifts, and I mean, there's a lot of stuff going on. Lots of thermos. When, you know, that's the reason why pilots get killed when they're flying these things, because it's hard to react to all of these things.
The reason I ask is because of the California suffered like a huge amount of forest fires just last year.
Yeah. Well, we're working with Cal Fire, and we're also working with the National Forest Foundation and Association. The National Forest Agency. They're the guys who approve these things, and they're the guys who put out the purchase orders to all the folks who come with aircraft to fight fires. And so we're working with them right now to adapt some kind of a vehicle for that. It'll just be for situational awareness, because there's a lot of things that happen in the fire.
All right, I think that was a very exciting thing. Again, thank you for coming. As I said, we are, ASA is a volunteer organization. We need your help in setting up different events, including this kind of event and other events that we have. We're looking always for the volunteers and people who are willing to work with us. We have an application outside for ASA. You can also go to our site, which is ASA.org, our new website, and you can become a member. Lazmik, do we have any other announcement, general announcement for the...
Before you do that, can I just say, I've got a bunch of brochures here. We have an event in December, and we also have one in September.
Yes.
This one in December is about all UAVs of all kinds. We have it at the LA Convention Center. Last year we had 20,000 people there. Love to have you at this thing, so you can come up, get a brochure. And then we have a logistics event coming, which will be in San Bernardino, about UAVs and robotics and logistics. Probably will come to it. It runs 3 days at the airport, so if you want to get
you to all right. Well, again, good night, and we'll see you again.